just like me.
He loves us.
Jesus.
Encore! Let's see. We give a round of applause for our worst team. Bringing it. Hope you know what? The worst team stole my microphone. Woo!
Yes, there it is.
I'm just kidding. Can you hear me? Hello, hello, hello. Can you hear me now? Alright. How's everybody doing? You guys get fed?
Yes.
Eat enough?
Yeah.
Alright, I'm gonna try to eat this mic so then that way you can hear me. Let me know if I gotta speak up or what's going on. We do not want to rehearse. We're going live. You know what? You guys encourage me when I get to see your wonderful faces on Wednesday. So thank you so much for being here. Rita, thank you so much for all your help. Yeah. I mean, Gabe, thank you. I don't know if you guys can see us at home, but Gabe's over there handling the lyrics.
I'm trying.
Oh, no, here's your handling, brother. You're handling. Lucy and Gary for all your guys' hard work. Raquel for leading them. Thank you so much. You're such an amazing worship leader. I want to just acknowledge you guys because, you guys, if it wasn't for you guys, I wouldn't be able to do what y'all do. I ain't singing. I'm pretty sure y'all want me not singing. You know, I make a joyful noise unto the Lord. You know, of course, I got Shanella and my mom and John and all you guys who are here. Craig, I heard this is your church now, so I'm excited. But you know, it's always been, brother. It's always been. You know what? Nicolina, thank you. I love you too, you know. Maddie, I think she might be in the nursery watching, or she's watching the kids. But, no, but in all seriousness, you know, it's been an amazing journey these last couple of Wednesdays, right? It seems like every time we have Wednesday, it snows or rains. So, you know, I appreciate you guys coming. I think it's going to grow, but, you know, like hopefully the food keeps bringing you back a little bit, you know what I mean? And the preaching hopefully keeps you staying. So, you know, I'm just thankful for you guys. I just wanted to say that before I started. But I'll be foolish to go forward without praying. So if we could bow our heads and close our eyes and open our hearts. Lord Jesus, as we get ready to study your word, Lord, speak through me. Let me get out of your way. Lord, your servants are here to listen, Lord. Let us not only listen with our ears, but listen with our hearts. Let us not only be hearers of the word, but doers of the word. And we all said,
Amen.
So we're still in chapter 5. We're going to be in chapter 5 for a while. Apparently chapter 5 is just really epic. You know, did they kick us out of Facebook Live again?
No.
I don't know. Last week they kicked us out of Facebook Live. Now that was hilarious. Because we don't own the rights to any music. I'm going to say that like every time I'm up here now. Chapter 5 of Matthew.
Oh, we are still in Matthew.
Yep, we're in Matthew. We especially during Bible study, we do, if I don't know, that's like the thing we do in this church is we don't ever want to be a bumper sticker church. I mean, as cool as bumper stickers are, I don't know. I used to have some pretty hoopties back in the day. And, you know, you can make your car look really good with like a nice little sticker on the bumper. But, you know, it's that idea is we don't want to just pick and choose scripture to make, to make a point that we want before, right? We only want to point to Jesus Christ.
Yes.
And I think all scripture points to Jesus Christ, so that's why it's important that we don't remove or take anything away. We don't add to it. So we study verse by verse.
Yes.
And, you know, and I tell you what, it's like it would be easier to kind of just pick and choose because there's like some scriptures I'm like, man, this is gonna get me some hallelujahs, some amens, and I get to go home. You know, like, but then, so there's other scriptures that, like, I tell you guys all the time that I have to wrestle with. Because I got to be honest with myself, and it's not easy looking in the Bible sometimes, right? When we look at the Bible, what does it do? It reveals us who we are. It reveals to us who we are. The Bible tells you, you mess it up, you know, right? It's like that friend you had that's just like, dude, you know, man. Yo, I was kidding. I think Michelina told me that in the show. Is your deodorant not working? I was like, that's mean. But you know what? It was true. So I couldn't be that mad at her. I was like, man, you know, I was using this natural stuff. I'm going with Dove, you know. But no, but it's honesty at its best when you go through the scriptures. Because, I mean, we should not walk away from the scriptures not knowing ourselves better. Because we approach it as the living word of God. We never come up here flippantly and just think it's something. I know I like to joke. I think that's just kind of way I communicate. I like to have fun and get some giggles. But, like, in all seriousness, the Bible is so important right now in this time, because there's so many people that will use it to confuse you or to even remove you from the church. They try to use it and turn it around and say it says this when you need to be studied up on it, so you can be like, no, don't. Yeah. Like we were studying earlier in the temptation of Christ, right? What does the devil do? The devil uses scripture. The devil knows scripture. So we better know scripture too, so we can say, no, that's you're misconstruing the message. Like I said, always hold me accountable and double check what I'm saying, so that way, you know, because I'm the guy up here. I'm accountable to the Lord Almighty, so I'm going to do my best to make sure I don't mess up. I'm in the hot seat, so to speak, right? But I'm accountable to you guys. You guys come say, like, hey, Pastor Mike, that didn't make sense. What were you meaning there? Because I would love to come up here and correct it or get it straight instead of let it linger or confuse you or sow confusion. So, and I get into that because we're going to be teaching about the law. I don't know how I said it that way, the law. But, you know, like, we're going to be going into, you know what, this was supposed to update, and it didn't update. Somebody come and read out of my Bible, a small print. Do you guys mind reading out a small print? Because it was supposed to be bigger print. But it was somebody read for us. Brother Gary, I love the way you read. Will you come and read the passage for us? We're going to be in chapter 5, verses 17 through 20 is what I need to be read today. You can come up here if you're down, just, or you can read it from right there.
No, I
did. I'm gonna try to find it. I had it for you guys, church, and then you know what? Now I feel like, oh, watch.
This is 17 through what?
I had to refresh it. You gotta love life, right here. Slideshow from the beginning. So go ahead and just read that for me, please, brother.
Don't misunderstand why I have come. I did not come to abolish the law of Moses or the writings of the prophets. No, I came to accomplish their purpose. I tell you the truth, until heaven and earth disappear, not even the smallest detail of God's law will disappear until its purpose is achieved. So if you ignore the least commandment and teach others to do the same, you will be called the least of the kingdom of heaven. But anyone who obeys God's laws and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. But I warn you, unless your righteousness is better than the righteousness of the teachers of religious law and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven.
Thank you, brother. I told you, I always tell Gary, like, he should do book audios.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, I could listen to you, like, read all day. I was like, yeah. I'm just saying, like, I listen to a lot of audio books, and you got a gift. But we'll be teaching about the law. And, like back then, there was like, three categories of laws, right? You had the ceremonial laws, the civil laws, and the moral laws. So you got your ceremonial laws, which included worship laws, regulations on sacrifices, and priesthood. And these laws all pointed ahead to Christ. We had the civil laws, which were government laws for the people of Israel, which is a theocracy. And also, like, they handled with, like, punishments for things, you know, that you did wrong. Then you had your moral laws. These are the most important laws. Moral laws are God's will for all people for all time. We are to love God and love your neighbor. Right? What does it say? Love your Lord and God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as you love yourself. That's the summation of all laws. So it's one of those things is we're going to be going a little bit deeper into what these laws mean, because we know that it's not by the laws that we're saved, but it's by grace, right? But the laws still have a job, because the moral giver, who is Christ, who is God, who is the Holy Spirit, came and told us this is how we need to live. Like during the time of Israel, they were ruled by a theocracy, right? Their law or their government was ran by God. So they had different sets of rules. But there's eternal rules set for all time, and those are those moral ones. Those are the ones that I was trying to tell you. Like, if you have a moral law, it's used to awaken your conscience and to expose our sin and to bring us to Christ in repentance. Those are the laws that Christ came to uphold. You know, like the civil law was used, for example, to build on and not strictly implement theocracy, but it's also like we see today that we grab some of those laws and bring them into, you know, governments of today because there's good laws. I mean, you know, thou shalt not kill. You know, this is a good idea to make sure people ain't over there murdering each other. You know what I mean? But murder is different than going to war because you go to war and you kill people, but yet you shouldn't murder. And I mean, there's a lot of things, right? And that's, like I said, people are going to use scripture and try to get you to wrestle with it. And that's kind of what they wanted to do with Jesus, right? Like they always were trying to catch him. I don't know about you guys, but like, especially since I became a pastor, but I think it's just when you become a Christian, people are trying to catch you. They're trying to catch you in saying something wrong or doing something wrong. Or catch you in being a hypocrite. I tell them, I'm honest. Like, I was like, hypocrisy runs rapid in the church. That's why we're in church, right? We do what we not do, and we end up doing the things that, or we don't do the things we should. I mean, as much as we're striving to do our best, we fall short. But we've all fallen short of the glory of God, right? We're all sinners. But God is working on us, and he's helping us. And the best way he does it is he gives us his revealed word in the Bible to help us understand what we need help with and what we're doing wrong. You know, like we need to know the diagnosis to get the cure. We need to know the disease. And my Bible says that I was diseased with sin. Like at the core of everything is not... Like, you know, there's a lot of bad things that happen, but it's all predicated on the original thing, which is sin. And all law is to help mitigate that. You know, we got a couple verses to talk about the moral law. It says in Galatians 3:24, let me put it another way. The law was our guardian until Christ came. It protected us until we could be made right with God through faith. But still, the law itself is holy, and its commands are holy and right and good. But how can that be? Did the law, which is good, cause my death? Of course not. Sin used what was good to bring about my condemnation to death. So we can see how terrible sin really is. It uses God's good commandments for its own evil purposes. And that's why I was telling you guys in the beginning. Is we see... People use scripture to point out our downfalls. But that's okay, because we should know what our downfalls are. Like I always tell, as ministers, we have a blind spot. I think we all have a blind spot. We don't see what's our worst traits, right? Maybe because we bat a blind eye to it. But we have brothers and sisters, guess what, that will lovingly, is my prayer for you guys, lovingly, right? I emphasize lovingly, point it out to you. Like we could go out there and point to the world what's wrong with the world, but they don't know better because that's the world. We're in a church of brothers and sisters, so we should be able to point to each other and say, hey man, I know you're doing this wrong, but how can me and you do it better? Because that's what Jesus came to do with us. He came to uphold the law, but you know, he knew, as much as I tell them not to do this, they're going to still mess up. And that's why he went and atoned for us. And that's why he went and died for us, because he knew he had to do it. But it's him with us that we could do more than ourselves. Right through Christ, all things are possible. You know, people will be like, no, what about the civil law? I mean, the scripture says you must not muzzle an ox and keep it from eating as it treads out the grain. And in another place, those who work deserve their pay. It is saying like, well, there's so much more going on, Mike, than morals. Why isn't God changing the civil laws? I don't know. It's tax season. God, why don't you change taxes? I feel like I shouldn't have to pay taxes, but guess what? That's the law. I got to do it. It's the right thing to do. I'm a good citizen. I'm going to pay my taxes. But, you know, like, I don't know about you guys, how many of you guys wish you didn't have to? I don't know. You know, if we're honest, I'm like, man, I worked really hard for that money. Thanks, Uncle Sam, for my busted roads. But, you know, like, so we could see where people would be like, well, where's your God there? Right? Or are you, well, you guys ain't holding true to those ceremonies you once had. Like, how come you guys ain't celebrating those things that they used to do back in the day in the Old Testament? What was going on? And so we were able to let them know. It's like, well, that was for that time with those people. But we don't condemn or argue with them because they have different ceremonies. People like ceremony. But we know, like, sacrifices and all those things were, they're no longer necessary if Jesus Christ was the ultimate sacrifice. We no longer need to sacrifice goats and oxes and things to the Lord for our sin because Jesus Christ was the Lamb of God.
You have a message from Ben
Peloton. Sorry, I don't know why I stopped there. I was like, I got a message, Lord? Just kidding. Yeah. But like I said, a ceremonial and a civil law, those are going to change with time. But the thing that is timeless is that moral law. And it's written in all our hearts even before we knew it. Like, I mean, you always had that, I'm a Disney guy. I liked Disney when I was younger. Pinocchio, right? Who's the little cricket dude? Jiminy Cricket. We all have a little Jiminy Cricket. We all have somewhat of a conscience. But just like Pinocchio, sometimes we ignore him. And that's never a good thing. But like, we know it more as we have God placed in our heart at least a moral aspect of knowing what is right and wrong. Some of us have an inkling. It takes practice to become totally just devout to not caring. It is disappointing, but people get there all the time. Where they're just like, I don't care. Nobody else cares. Why should I care? But I'm here to tell you, God cares. He cares enough that he came down to fulfill his law. He said, well, you guys took my law and pretty much just ignored it. Well, I'm going to come down and I'm going to fulfill it. So that way I can make a bridge back to me because you guys have missed the mark. And that's love. Because he loves us. He came to tell us what we were doing wrong. That's why I titled today's message, Love is Law. Because it was the summation of all the laws, all the commands by God. And he said, love your Lord God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Love. He came to love us, but in order to love us, he had to give us the law. He had to give us the rules. Like, I remember when I was younger, I used to, my mama tested this, she's right here in the front row. But you know, like, she always wondered where I was at, what I was doing. Always nagging me about me not coming home when I was supposed to. And I used to be like, man, tell my cousin, why can't mom be cool like yours? She don't care. Not that she didn't care, but she didn't get on his case, right? She cared, but she just, you know, she never like sweated him for, you know, going around the streets. And my cousin told me one time, he said, man, I wish my mom was like your mom. Because she cares. And now, you know, that blew my mind because, you know, that makes sense. A caring person is going to wonder where you are. They're going to worry about where you are. They're going to want you where you need to be. But you're not going to feel that love or that care from somebody if they're just going to leave you where you're at. You know, and sadly, in today's culture, too many people feel that way, that nobody cares. And like I said, oh, you got someone who cares, and he cares more than you could ever know. And that is our Lord Jesus Christ. So in 5:17, remember, this is still the Sermon on the Mount. He's still talking to him. He just finished, you know, talking about the Beatitudes. And then we talked last week about the salt and light, how you guys are to look to the world. Now he's saying, okay, well, this is how you're going to behave while you're in the world. How you gonna behave? Well, you got the rules, and you got the law. And because people would have looked at him, they're like, oh, maybe he's gonna get rid of all those old things and then start something new, like a revolutionary, right? Away with the old, in with the new. He says, whoa, whoa, whoa. Don't misunderstand why I have come. I did not come to abolish the law of Moses or the writings of the prophets. No, I came to accomplish their purposes. He said, I came to make sure that the purpose of God is fulfilled. In Romans 3:31, it says, well, then, if we emphasize faith, does this mean that we can forget about the law? Of course not. In fact, only when we have faith do we truly fulfill the law. Well, I love that because it's that idea. We can know what to do, but it takes God to help us do it. You know what I mean? Like I know what I need to do, but I can't do it without him. Like, because when I tried repeatedly to do things without God. I don't know, maybe that's why my nose is flat, because I've fallen flat on my face plenty of times. You know, like, I mean, so I think sometimes he just lets you too. You're just like, oh, that's going bad. And he got that look. I got that look sometimes when I'm looking at my son, like, that is a bad idea. You know, everybody's probably like, why don't you stop him? I don't know, he's going to learn. He's not going to learn that way. No, I'm just kidding. I stop him, it's going to be bad. But, you know, I let him figure things out on his own, right? Because God wants you to figure it out. Because the whole time I'm right there, I'm ready to help Ben. That's my son, if y'all don't know. You know, I'm ready to help him, but you know, that's what God. God's like, I'm right here. Let me help you. And he's looking at all these people, he's saying, you guys know the rules, you know the law. And instead of you guys achieving what the law requires, you guys are just hoping that I get rid of it. So if I get rid of it, then we would all be messed up. It would be bad for everybody. So he says, for assuredly I say to you, till heaven and earth pass away, one jot or one tittle will by no means pass from the law till all is fulfilled. And if you don't know what a jot or a tittle is, think about the dot on the top of an I. A little comma right there. Like I'm horrible with commas. I put them where they don't belong, and I don't put them where they do. Like punctuation, not for me. You know what I mean? So I'm glad I didn't have to write this. But did you know, like, when they used to write the Old Testament down, like they took it so serious, every letter, that they would ceremonially clean themselves and just, and then pray and everything. Another one. I mean, now I throw it on a screen. You know, but it's still just as amazing and just as sacred. You know, nothing has changed. It's still God's word. Like, that should hold so much weight. And I think sometimes we lose it because we see it on. And I'm the worst person of it. I got it on shirts. I got it on. I'm just excited. I love God's word. You know, I'll try to put it everywhere because I need to be reminded. But, you know, people see that and they're just like, that doesn't mean what it used to. Well, then that's nobody's fault but your own, because it should mean that every time you see it. Every time you see it, it should have that weight to it. Like, I pray to God that when I write it on my shirt, I'm not just sporting because I'm like, oh, look, I'm a pastor. Pick it up. 99. You know, like, I got to show you. I'll see that. Like, I don't want to be that. I want to be, like, literally living that word that I'm wearing. I want people to see that, like, you know, Jack jokes around. Jack, if you're watching this, I gotta bring it up, because he said, you know, when he's driving, sometimes he feels like he has to remove that fish sticker on his car, you know, because he's saying, you know, like, man, you know, sometimes I don't want to live that way because everything else is going the wrong way. You know, it's tough, right? Like, I mean, you're like, Christian, when you walk out that door, you're like, Christ follower, you're like, I'm going to love all my neighbor. I'm going to love God. It's going to be amazing. And then right away, somebody cuts you off. And you're like, ooh, I don't love that guy as much as I should. And then the next guy flips you off. And you're like, what's wrong with this guy? And then all of a sudden, you're just thankful that you have that shirt. You're just like, oh, man, look who that. Right? But it's serious. God's saying, no, like, remind yourself of this all the time because you're going to need it.
Yes.
Amen.
You're going to need a reminder.
Yes.
And Luke says it this way. That doesn't mean that the law has lost its force. It is easier for heaven and earth to disappear than for the smallest point of God's law to be overturned. He's saying, God's word. What created existence? God spoke. That's more eternal than the thing it created. God's word is everlasting and forever. Forever and ever. We were singing that song, right? In 19a, it starts off by saying, so if you ignore the least commandment and teach others to do the same, you will be called the least in the kingdom. What does that mean? I thought this picture was perfect for it. Yeah, right? Because what happens is when you start to ignore, especially if like you're in leadership like myself, but like I mean, just everybody's going to look to you, even if they don't know God or they don't know church or whatever. Guess who they're going to look for when they're seeking godly things? Well, the person that goes to church or the person that follows God, right? They're going to look at how you handle things. Like I said, they're going to be looking at that car with the fish on it and be like, well, how's he handling this guy driving like that? And then if he looks over and you're like, ah, you know, they're going to be like, exactly, that's why I don't go. It's the same thing, you know, nothing changed. We look at you and you're just jamming. I bet you Raquel does. She's probably just jamming to worship you. She's like, hallelujah. She's probably just singing away, and people are just like, man, you seem happy. They get a second look, and then they might just be like, well, you know what, maybe I should check out that church thing. But what ends up happening is when we just ignore, you know, just do things that, like, just ignores what God is telling us to do, then people are going to start to follow our example. And we might as well be cutting our own branch. And the worst part is somebody else, they're like, oh, well, he's doing it, I'm going to do it. You know, like, I mean, I think that's why we're equated with sheep sometimes. Sometimes we don't make the wisest choice, you know. I think people will call it, it's a real thing, like mob mentality. If you see everybody doing one thing, generally you're going to follow right along. Right off the edge of a hill or whatever. Like, we're called to do different than the rest of the world. When everybody's going left, we're going to go right. And we do this because it says, but if anyone who obeys God's law and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. And how do we teach something? Like I said, kids, they don't do what you tell them. They do what you show them. Mm-hmm. They imitate you. And that's everything. You know, I can tell my kid, don't be on the phone. It's not cool. You got to read, whatever, you know. But then he sees me on the phone. Guess what he's going to want to do? He ain't going to. Ain't gonna be grabbing a book.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's just that idea is they're gonna imitate you, and actions speak louder than words. So we show the world that we're obeying God. And what it teaches the rest of the world is that, you know, I know who I belong to. I know who is my master. And I love it because it says when we get to heaven, then it says we'll be great. Of course we'll be great. We're in heaven. You know, like I can't even like fathom how great that would feel. I don't know about you guys, but when I do a good job, one of my love languages is words of affirmation. I like people saying, "Oh, you did a good job." I'm not fishing for compliments, but you know that's how I like it. Just kidding. Actually, as I think I've gotten older, I think it's more now acts of love. But it's a book, Five Love Languages, great book if everyone agrees. But you know, it's one of those things is, man, like, we're our brother Gary and my sister Raquel, they want to sing a song, Well Done, for our brother Ray's funeral, right? What is that? Well done, my good and faithful servant. I was kind of thinking in my head, I was like, hey, God's going to say that to Ray, and Ray's going to be like, it's the Holy Spirit. And you know what? And that's the right thing to say. And that is perfect. That is the right thing to say, because literally we get a crown when we get to heaven, and we get the crown, but you know what we do is we give that crown right back to God, because we said, you're the reason why I got this crown.
Mm-hmm.
where he got.
And isn't that so cool? Because that was our brother Ray. That's what he would be like, oh, no, it was me as the Holy Spirit. And that's biblical living. That was him teaching others. Because now, when Rita's downstairs cooking, I'm like, man, Rita, you did a fantastic job. Holy Spirit. You know, I think that's just going to be in the church forever. We're just going to, you know, because that's how it should be in the church. Amen. He gave us a good example to go by. In James 2:10, it says, for the person who keeps all of the laws except one is as guilty as a person who has broken all of God's laws. So I had to put that one in because it marks, we got to remember that just one sin gets in and ruins the whole thing. Like, you know what I mean? Because that's what it is. Like, a little yeast leavens the whole bread, is the way they put it. But it's just saying it only takes just a little, you know, BET, you know. And then all of a sudden you're watching something worse. I don't even, BET is still out. But I mean, I think my niece is like, there's no such thing as BET. All right, there was when I was younger. MTV used to be music videos. Yeah, I think the older people are like, oh, I know what you're talking about. You know, like, after hours, yeah, you watch that, and you're just like, this action, you're watching this. And then all of a sudden, it gets worse. I'm using that as an example, boy, that could be with anything in your life. It could, you know, it could be smoking. You know, you're like, oh, man, I cut the habit, but then all of a sudden, oh, you know, one drag, that won't hurt. And then all of a sudden, you're back to two packs a day or something. Like it's the same with sin. We let it in and it tries to just take over. You know, what does it say? The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. But thank God that the spirit in me is greater than the spirit in this world. Amen. And then I love this. Jesus looks at everybody. Everybody's probably like, man, this guy, I thought I liked him. Now he's telling me I gotta do all these things. I thought he was going to start a revolution, but now he wants me to go and follow all the rules. And then he's like, well, you know, okay, I could probably handle that. And then he says, well, for I say to you that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven. And so these were the guys, right? These were the people they had pointed to when they were talking about them church folk, when they were talking about them holy people, holy rollers, right? You saw Pharisees. And you were like, man, they got it together. Man, look at them. They dress all great. And they never do nothing wrong. They just must just wake up and just do everything right. And the problem was is they were doing all kinds of ceremonial stuff, and they were doing all kinds of things that they could achieve on their own. But what they were not doing was admitting that they needed God because they were sinners. They were still missing the mark because no matter what they did on their own, they still couldn't pay for the sin because even though they did a sin ever, but they sinned that one sin, guess what it did? It leavened the whole bread. They were just as guilty as everyone else. Remember, I don't know if you guys remember Nicodemus, right? What did he tell Nicodemus? Nicodemus, I tell you, surely you need to be born again. This is the teacher of religious law. This is the guy that you went to find out these things of God. And here's Jesus saying, no, you need to just throw that all out the window. It's good, and it blessed your life, right? He was the teacher of religious law. He was good. But the problem was he wasn't good with God. Like, think about that. There's a lot of people in this world that are good. Like, not only, like, in the aspect, like, they're good people, but, like, they're well off, right? You see them, and they're not living right by God, but they got, like, the nice cars, they got the nice jewelry, whatever. And you're like, what's going on with that? But God's saying, well, that's they can't take that with them where they're going to go. We go back into heaven with the things that we came into this world with. That was nothing. You know, like, that's why he says, store your treasure up in heaven, where things will not rust or decay. Being more righteous than the Pharisees, right? It says the Pharisaic righteousness was built on self-effort and external behavior. They tried to keep the law to the dot. The righteousness Jesus seeks goes beyond self-effort external behavior, or keeping the law to the dot. It demands an inner change, a loving obedience. I love that. It's an inner change, a loving obedience. Because the title of this, Love is Law. Loving obedience. We obey Him because we love Him. Not because we have to, but because we want to. Because what I realized as I got older, now that I have my own kids, all my dad ever wanted me to do was just to listen to him. But like instead of listening to him, I just wanted things from him. You know, and he would have just loved it if I just obeyed what he said. You know, it didn't have to be something big. He wasn't telling me obey him because he knew better. He was just saying this could be better if you do it this way. Don't do it like this, do it like this, because I see that if you do it like this, it's going to hurt. But I still love you, I'm still your father. And God, He still loves us forever, forever, amen, right?
Amen.
In Deuteronomy 26, 16, it says, today the Lord, your God, has commanded you to obey all these decrees and regulations, so be careful to obey them wholeheartedly. You have declared today that the Lord is your God, and you have promised to walk in His ways, and to obey His decrees, commands, and regulations, and to do everything He tells you. So, in Deuteronomy, you know, he's talking to the Israel, and he's saying, this is what you guys are doing, but that's what we pledge to do when we accept Christ into our lives. Like, as much as we want forgiveness, it comes with this. Because we have to obey Him. We have to make Him the master of our lives. We need to become His slaves. We need to become, like, His servant is great, but we need to be His slaves because He is our master. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And when we're here on this world, we decide that we're going to follow all His decrees, all His commands, all His regulations. Yes. And how? Wholeheartedly, with everything we've got. We're talking about commands, so I felt like I got to go through a couple of the commandments. So I'll just go through all 10. but yeah, I don't know, you guys are looking at me. My kids just walked in, so everybody's like, who's bringing the loud kid? That's my kid. I'm sorry, y'all. I'm sorry. But think about this, though. You read all 10 of these, and then I'm going to read them. It says, I am the Lord your God. You shall not have strange gods before me. You shall not make to thyself any graven thing, nor the likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or in the earth beneath, nor of those things that are in the waters under the earth. You shall not adore them, nor serve them. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. Remember to keep the holy Sabbath. And it also says, honor your father and your mother. You shall not kill. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife. And you shall not covet your neighbor's goods. And we read that because it goes right back to what Jesus is saying. If you notice, the first four is your commands, how you're to treat God. And the next six are your commands on how you're to treat your neighbor. And that's amazing because Jesus sums it up so much easier than me reading all that. He just says, you shall love your Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. And you shall love your neighbor as yourself. He sums it all up with that, with those words. Because if you love your God, you won't do the things that are against the law. And if you love your neighbor, you won't break the law against your neighbor. Because love is law. Next week, come. I don't know what we're going to be cooking. I can't, like I told y'all, and I don't want to lie to y'all, but it's going to be good. You know. But next week, we're going to be teaching about anger. So if you guys want to read that, that's the next section. That is Matthew 21 through 26. So if we can get the worship team to come back up here, thank you guys for letting me talk with y'all and worship with y'all. Song on there for you. So we'll see how I did. You still got under presentation. guys can all stand so we get a sing. Facebook, we don't know the rights to this music. All right, brother, you got this?
You part the sea.